First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for this possibility to give a talk at this conference. The problem I'm going to talk about is like this. Let us have a measure, a finite measure on on the unit circle, a finite positive measure on the unit circle. As soon as we have this, we consider the space L2 with respect to mu, and we can calculate the distance, the square distance in this situation, between z bar and the polynomials of order up to n minus 1, yes? Which, well, we can rewrite this because everything is symmetric. As a distance from Zn to all these polynomials, or the integral, the infimum of the integrals over the polynomials of order n, which are normalized at the origin, or if you want, the infimum of the monic polynomials of order n. Okay, so we are given a measure, and we obtain a sequence En. This is a, it's it's a non-increasing sequence of positive numbers. There is a misprint here. And in fact, the sequence in fact decreases unless it has already reached zero, yes? One more trivial remark is that these numbers are monotonic with respect to the measure, yes? If one measure is moderated by another one, then the corresponding coefficients are moderated. What can we say about the behavior of these coefficients En? There is a result which is associated at least with three people. First of all, Segio, who considered the who considered a partial case of this for absolutely continuous measures, and then Verblunsky and then Kolmogorov, who proved together such a result. A measure mu belongs to the so-called Segio class, meaning that the limit of the coefficient is strictly positive if it, and only if the integral, the log integral of the derivative, of the Riordan-Nikodym derivative of our measure is finite. Okay, this is a classical result. And then as soon as we know what is the limit, we can ask how rapidly can we reach this limit, yes? How rapidly will we approach this limit in terms of the measure, yeah? What is the asymptotical behavior? Here, one preliminary remark is that if we replace our, if we start with a Lebesgue measure preserving automorphism of the unit circle, and we applied this automorphism to our measure, then belonging to the Segio class is not changed under such operation. On the other hand, we'll see that the behavior of these En coefficients can change very much under such an operation. And that explains why the problem of describing this asymptotical behavior looks rather challenging. A probabilistic motivation was important for us in considering this problem. So let's start with a stationary sequence or a stationary process on integers. For us, this will mean that for every k and for every numbers, integers m and 1 up to nk, we can consider two k-tuples like this and this one shifted by m, and they should be equidistributed. And this, once again, for every k and for every m and 1 nk. Later on, we assume that our random variables zeta, zeta zero, and so all the other zetas, they have finite second moment. And for normalization, we assume that the expectation is equal to zero. Now we can consider the sequence, the covariance sequence, yes? With indices which are also integers. And it's easy to see that this sequence is positively defined. So by the Bochner-Herlotz theorem, this sequence, they are just the Fourier coefficients for the so-called spectral measure mu of our sequence, zeta. This is, well, a finite positive measure on the unit circle. In principle, if you have a stationary sequence, the set of its values may be arbitrary. Then again, if you consider a general stationary sequence, the set, every finite positive measure could be a spectral measure of such a sequence. So they are, these two parameters are free. On the other hand, as soon as we start to impose some conditions on the set of values, some other conditions appear on the spectral measures. And here we have two results which demonstrate this relation. The first result, once again, we have a stationary sequence, which is normalized and with finite second moment. Mu is its spectral measure. And then Yuriyenko and Tasovsky proved that if, by chance, all the values our sequence takes are on the unit circle, are unimodular, and if the support of our spectral measure is contained in an arc of length less than pi, then it turns out that there is a huge degeneration, yes? In fact, our sequence is just a power sequence, yes? For some random t and some random s. So for every realization of sequence, it is like this, for some t and s. Another result which we obtained recently with Misha Sodin and Benji Weiss is like this. Suppose that the set of values now is just a uniformly discrete subset of the unit of the complex plane, yes? Meaning that every two points in the set, the distance is larger than some positive constant. Suppose that also our spectral measure satisfies this property. What does it mean? It means that we are not in the Segur class, En tend to zero, but not only that, they tend to zero sufficiently rapidly, yes? So that the sequence is square integrable. Then suddenly, it turns out that almost surely our sequence is a periodic sequence. And if additionally, stochastic process is ergodic, then the sequence is periodic. The difference is that if we don't assume the ergodicity condition, then the period is a random number which depends on the realization. And in the second situation, it's just a fixed number. Yeah? So that's why we started to be interested in the behavior of these coefficients. Okay, what is known about the behavior of the coefficients En. From now on, we will identify the unit circle with just R factorized by Z. The first results on the which we consider here correspond to the Segur class measures, and they were obtained by Grenader Rosenblatt in 54 and Ibrahimov 64. Ibrahimov, so you can see also that the problem was of interest to probabilists. Suppose that we have a measure in the Segur class. We have a parameter p, which is strictly larger than 1/2, and it's not an integer. And we are interested in the difference between En square and the limit, the square limit. Then this difference delta n decays like this, polynomially with parameter 2 pi, if and only if two conditions are satisfied. First of all, well, the square bracket of p is the integer part, so the corresponding derivative is in L2 on the unit circle, and we have some smoothness condition on this piece derivative, yes? Integral type smoothness condition. This is what is happening for polynomial decay of the parameters delta n. And if you are interested in what is happening when do we have more rapid rate of approximation, like exponential rate of approximation, well, the answer is that corresponding phi should be much more smooth. In fact, it should have a holomorphic extension into an annulus containing the unit circle. Okay. What is happening outside of the Segur class? First of all, if our measure has a gap, if there is an interval disjoint with the support of our measure, then the coefficients decay exponentially. It is an easy fact. On the other hand, it's not a characterization, and one can easily construct measures with exponential decay such that the support, the closed support, covers the whole unit circle. It turns out that it's not so simple to characterize the measures with exponential decay. Erdős and Turan in 1940 proved that if the derivative of the absolutely continuous part is strictly positive almost everywhere, then our sequence is sub-exponential. And then Stalin Totik, experts in orthogonal polynomials, they have a book published in 1992, and there they prove a number of results. Well, the typical result is like this. If for almost every x on the unit circle, such a limit is zero, what does it mean? Well, r goes to zero, so the logarithm should come to minus infinity less rapidly than r goes to zero, yes? So we should have the masses of such intervals should decay less rapidly than exponential, yes? And this should be true for all x, well, for almost all x. Then we are in a sub-exponential situation. They have several results like this, but for every result, they also produce a counterexample which shows that the corresponding condition is not well, if it's a sufficient condition for sub-exponentiality, then it's not necessary. And if they have some necessary conditions, they are not sufficient. Okay, so this is where we wanted to study this problem, and we started with such a natural situation, I would say. Suppose that we have a measure which with density which vanishes just at, say, at the point zero, yes, at one point. We have a measure with one deep zero, yes? The density is exponential minus h, and the function h looks like this at the origin, yes? For simplicity, we assume that our weight h is even, it decays, and of course we assume that the integral of h is infinity, yes, to be outside of the Segeur class. Then under some regularity conditions, there are two sets of regularity conditions, so our h should satisfy either A or B, we introduce some numbers. It's easy to see that for every n, we can find a n which grows to infinity with n satisfying this property. And our first result is that in this situation, the logarithm of one of our coefficients, e n of mu, is equivalent to such an integral. Well, if there is no minimum here, if it's just the integral of h, it will be plus infinity. But in fact, we integrate just the minimum of h and a n. Yes. When n grows, a n also grows. This minimum grows, and so the corresponding integral tends to infinity. And the rate with which it tends to infinity describes how rapidly these numbers tend to infinity. More concretely, we have such examples. Yeah? We start with a weight which is just barely non-integrable. Yes? In this situation, we obtain that the logarithm of one of our coefficients is equivalent to log log n. So our coefficients decay like a power of the logarithm. Then when we permit a bit more growth for our h, then we obtain an asymptotics like this. Say for p equal to zero, when our h is just one over t, yes? A basic divergent, a basic function for which the integral diverges, we'll get here just the logarithm of n. And so our en decay polynomially. Then we can permit even more growth, yes, like 1 over t power p for p larger than 1. And here we get the degree of decay like exponential of a power of n. A power which, as p grows, tends to 1, yes? Finally, if we consider a very large weight, we'll get our decay closer and closer to exponential decay. Still, it can never be exponential because, at least morally, because there is no gap in the support of our function. But we can get arbitrarily closely to the exponential decay. In particular, these results imply, say, for our probability question, that there exists an absolute constant such that if we have a stationary ergodic process with values, say, plus minus one, and with the spectral measure, which is measurized by this, yes? So has at least one zero, which is deep in this sense, then our sequence is periodic. Okay. This is what is happening with one deep zero. Of course, it's a very special result. What can we do? What are other more general situations? Well, we can think about something like this. Suppose that we have a zero measure compact on the circle. We can think about a measure which vanishes at this compact and near this compact. Yes? This is what we get in this situation. Suppose we have a compact subset of the unit circle. We introduce dk. This is just the distance to our compact k. And we are interested in compacts with regular geometric behavior. We say that k is gamma regular for some gamma between 0 and 1 if the measure of the S neighborhood of our set, yes, the measure of the subset of the points on the unit circle which are at distance less than S from k, if this measure behaves like a power 1 minus gamma of our parameter S. Two typical examples here is the standard 1/3 Kandor set, which is regular with a constant log 2 over log 3, and the set of points which converge to the point 1 with power rate. Yes, with rate parameterized by this delta is equal to this gamma, obviously. So this is 1 over delta plus 1 regular set. And a typical result which we are able to get in this situation is like this. Suppose that we have a measure which vanishes on k with this rate. This is rate gamma, which corresponds to the regularity characterization of our compact k. Then I'm afraid there is a logarithm which is missing here. In fact, then our coefficients tend to zero with a polynomial rate. One more example here is like this. If we, once again, in this situation when our compact k consists of points which converge to 1 with power rate delta, and we have such a measure, which is just exponential of the distance to k power p, for p larger than this delta over delta plus 1, then once again, the logarithm is missing here, is n to this power. So we have exponential, we have the decay of the kind exponential of power n. Once again, this exponent p minus kappa over p plus kappa is less than 1. Dk power p, yes. Here it was power gamma minus 1, here it's power p. Excuse me?
Gamma minus 1 is negative and p is positive.
That's a good point. Yes, of course, it's minus p. It's minus p, yes. Too many misprints. Okay. This is what is happening in the sub-exponential situation. We can ask ourselves, what can we say about the measures which correspond to the super-exponential decay? Here we have a complete characterization. So suppose that we have a finite positive measure. We would like to know when our coefficients En decay superexponentially. What does it mean morally is that the support of our measure should be very small. But in what sense? It turns out that the necessary sufficient condition is like this. For every epsilon and A positive, there exists N0 such that for every N larger than or equal to N0, there is a set which is a union of at most N arcs on the unit circle satisfying two properties. These two E are En, in fact. So first of all, the logarithm capacity is less than epsilon. And second, the amount of the mass which remains outside of the set is exponentially small. So the idea is that the bulk of our measure is contained in a very small set in the sense of logarithmic capacity. And what remains is just a very small mass. Unfortunately, the proof we have does not permit us to answer neither of these three questions, which, as I've told you, were of interest to specialists for a long time. How to characterize the measures of sub-exponential decay precise sense or some variance, how to characterize when the upper limit or the lower limit will be strictly negative. It remains unclear. One more example I'd like to give here. We would like to characterize the behavior of En of mu in terms of mu, but a priori it's not clear what properties of the measures mu should we look for. That's why we should consider so many examples to try to understand what is important, what is not. And one nice example of a continuous singular measure is comes from the Ries products. Let us start with a sequence of integers which grows at least like this, and some parameters between minus 1 and 1, some real parameters, alpha j. Then we can consider such functions on the unit circle. Well, they are just trigonometric polynomials. And then we consider the measures mu n, which are these trigonometric polynomials times the Lebesgue measure. And one can easily see that they are probability measures. We can pass to the weak limit, and we can define the limit mu, the limit measure mu. It is known that this limit measure is a continuous singular measure if and only if the coefficients alpha j are not very small. So this is a nice example of a rather symmetric continuous singular measure. It turns out that we can get good estimates on the corresponding parameters E for such a measure. If we denote by Tn the sum of Lj up to this number, then the coefficients satisfy this property, minus logarithm of the coefficients E with index Tn of our mu is equivalent to this sum. As I've told you, well, we are interested in the situation when this sum tends to infinity, yes? In particular, if all aj are just one, then we can get such a rather precise result. Well, not very precise, because we don't know whether one of these two estimates is exact, or in fact the truth is somewhere in between, but at least they are not very far away. Okay, so these are some examples, some results we obtain, and then, as usual, when you cannot get a complete description, complete answer to the problem, you can ask yourself what is happening under perturbation, yes? Suppose that it's complicated for us to calculate the asymptotics of E and of mu, but what is happening if we change mu a bit? What is happening with our coefficients? And here, Nivai proposed such a hypothesis in 85 about the relative Segeau asymptotics. His hypothesis is like this: if you have a measure and you have a multiplier which is positive almost everywhere, and this multiplier itself is in the Segeau class, suppose that you have this, so it's a nice multiplier, yes? His hypothesis is that then there should be this relative Segeau asymptotics when we calculate En of phi mu and divide that by En of mu, then the limit should exist and should coincide with E of phi, phi m, which is just, as you recall from the Segeau theorem, 1/2 of the integral of log phi dm. This was his hypothesis of, 34 years ago. And of course, this is true if our measure itself is in the Segeau class, because this is just the consequence of the Segeau theorem, yes? Because the limit of this will be the log integral of phi mu prime, of this one will be the log integral of mu, the exponentials of them, of mu prime. I think I should add the exponential here, but you understand it. This is true for the Segeau class measures, and there is a detailed discussion in the two-volume treatise of Barry Simon, orthogonal polynomials on the unit circle 1 and 2. And it is sometimes true also when our measure is not in the Segeau class, but the multiplier phi is sufficiently smooth. And at least two results we obtained at the same time, 86, 1 year after Nivai proposed his hypothesis, by Nivai, by Rachmaninoff. And typical results is like this: if our phi is Lipschitz, then we have, this is true. Well, for Lipschitz functions, it's okay. In general, it was unknown, but it turned out after we considered all the examples I've told you before that that the hypothesis is not true. In fact, it's not true in a very strong sense. That is, if you have any measure with the derivative strictly positive almost everywhere, which is not in the Segeau class. I've told you it should not be. If it's Segeau class, Nivai hypothesis is true automatically. Then for every sequence which tends to zero arbitrarily slowly, there exists a multiplier phi, which is not only in the Segeau class, but its logarithm is integrable with any power, such that these coefficients, En phi mu, tend to zero more slowly than epsilon n. So in fact, no version of Nivai hypothesis could be true. This condition is necessary for us, because otherwise, if there is a gap, then the sequence will decay exponentially. And one more remark is that what is happening here is that we multiply by phi. This phi should be unbounded, in fact. And the coefficient are much larger, much less small than the coefficients En of mu. So in this example, our phi should be unbounded. Its supremum should be infinite. And of course, if phi is less than or equal to one, then at least these coefficients will be like this. That's why we asked ourselves whether it's possible to get another reason for the Nevers hypothesis to fail. And in fact, it is possible. There exists a measure with derivative between 0 and 1 and a multiplier between 0 and 1, which is in this Eger class, such that when we multiply by this multiplier, the coefficients become infinitely smaller than the coefficients En of mu. So for the moment, it looks like this relative Segeur asymptotics business is more dead than alive. Okay, and or just the problem is much more complicated than people thought before. Okay, thank you.